In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. So the story goes, my parents said that in recent years said it's not actually true, but I still think it was a true story. I was originally named Christopher. My parents named me Christopher, and then as my grandparents said, they started to think about it, somebody came up to them and said, Christmas. And they realized that there'd be years and years of being picked on, so they changed my name to Benjamin. So, it was a little bit funny that I was the first in my family to be born to two non-Jewish parents. So naming Christmas might be a little bit, but they settled on a good Jewish name, Benjamin. So. But I always remembered that, and then as I got a little bit older, it didn't really matter what my first name is, because you get to high school and college, they call you by your last name. All my buddies would call me Moss. And then, after a few taking Spanish, they realized that Moss means more. So when everybody would call me Moss, a few of them would heckle, "No Moss." And as I think of Christmas, I think of those two words put together, which is not actually how Christmas came to be. It doesn't actually mean more Christ. But it is it's Christ Moss, Mass, the service for Christ. But I want us to think about it in our hearts. How do we make this day, how do we make Christ coming into our hearts, how do we make the light of the world coming into the world more? How do we make Christ more this Christmas? I started thinking about my favorite Christmas book, and a couple years ago, the librarian at the school asked all the staff what their favorite Christmas book was, and I couldn't remember the name of it, but I remembered it was about a Christmas tree, and I looked it up, it was called Mr. Willoughby's Christmas Tree. And Mr. Willoughby gets an enormous Christmas tree. He's a wealthy man. He has an enormous Christmas tree. They can barely get it in. They put it right there in the front lobby, and they get it all the way up, and they realize it's just a little bit too tall. It actually brushes against the ceiling. And so they cut a little bit of it off, and Mr. Willoughby has a wonderful idea that his maid could use the rest of it. And so the maid takes the Christmas tree home, and she goes and she decorates it, and she's absolutely overjoyed with it, but she realizes that it's more than she needs. So she cuts the top of it off. And then the gardener comes by and says, who would draw out a Christmas tree on Christmas Eve? So he takes the Christmas tree, takes it home, and his wife's so excited, and then they realize as they set it on their table, that it's more than they need. And so they cut the top of the Christmas tree off. Now, why they don't cut from the bottom like the rest of the time? It's a children's story. So they throw it out, and Mr. Bear walks by. We take a little bit of a transition from people to bears. So he walks by and he says, boy, I'm going to be really popular at home. So he takes the Christmas tree, what's left of it, and he brings it to his house. And they decorate and they realize that they don't have enough decorations for it all, so they cut the top off theirs. And then a bunny comes along, and the bunny does the same thing. And the cute part is the bunny actually takes a bit of turnip or a piece of carrot, cuts a width of it, and then hollows it out, and they put the, but it leans a little bit too much because it's too heavy, so they have to cut a little bit off theirs. And so then they put that out, and then the mouse comes and takes the remaining of the Christmas tree and makes Christmas for his family. And I think about what a beautiful thing it is that everybody got to have this Christmas celebration, thanks to people realizing what was enough, and for being able to share with other people. And as we take those candles that we'll take, as we sing Silent Night, we take those candles and we'll light the candle of the person next to us, and we'll go all along the pews. But I want you to think about two things when we do that. One, something incredible. A light came into the world that no darkness could put out. And that light came for everyone. That light came to folks in a lowly manger, outcasts keeping watch over their sheep by night, to everyone. And as you pass forward, think about how you shine that light in other people's lives. How do you make Christ more in your life, in your family's life? How do you make that light burn brighter in other people's lives? How do we make Christ more? So I invite you, as you leave here, as you continue your Christmas celebration, as you're filled with joy and surrounded by those that you love, that you think about that and think of some tangible way that you can make Christmas, make Christ more this year. More in your own hearts, more in your family, and then, of course, more to those outside of you. And you pass that light on. So that in 2017, Christ can indeed be born, and light must shine more brightly. And Christmas doesn't just take place one day a year, but is burning bright forever. Amen.
Amen.